Is there anything that artificial intelligence can't do? Its biggest challenge today could possibly be battling trolls on the internet, because we all know that's expert level stuff right there. Google is taking up the challenge with conversation AI, tools that are designed to use the power of machine learning to locate trollish and abusive language so it can be acted on. Basically, it's using AI to make people be nice. Be nice. What do you think? Is this going to succeed? Is this too big of a challenge even for AI? What do you think, Scott?
Well, this reminds me of the recent conversation surrounding Facebook's big mess they got into with showing the Vietnam era photo of the very iconic photo of the girl fleeing a napalm strike in Vietnam. And she happened to have all of her clothes burned off of her. So what you had there was a naked person. And Facebook's algorithm saw that as, oh, no, there's a minor shown naked on Facebook. We can't have this. And obviously, the machine learning there decided to remove it. Well, there's lots of conversation and arguments about, well, this is not the right context for that. And therefore, this was, not good. The machine didn't do very well. So all I'm saying about this is I'm all for machine learning. I'm all for AI figuring out ways to make our lives run smoother and to, be able to handle content in a way that's conducive to whoever the audience is, and all that stuff is important and good. However, we are not done with these moments of computer faux pas, nor are we done with the companies in charge of these things, in this case, Google, in their case, Facebook, blaming it on the algorithms and blaming it on the machine learning. So the very thing that they're touting as the hot new technology that they've got their hands in is also the thing they seem to want to distance themselves from when those AIs make big mistakes.
What I think is unique about Jigsaw is, this whole project, it's a global project in order to make people safer. And so at the same time they're working on keeping people safe from free speech, they're also working on curbing harassment. So the two things together, like say for being able to have free speech and at the same time keep people safer from harassment, which, making sure those two things are intertwined, I think is really important here. And I would love to see it work. I mean, I'm with you, like Facebook blamed the algorithm for that picture. But at the same time, I thought that was a positive story. That picture got put up right away. It happened fast, and the algorithm said, okay, that's a picture that, that deserves to be up. It's not pornography, it's not child pornography. So I believe in the algorithm to work, but I totally agree with you that the big companies are going to blame the algorithm for as long as they can. So
it'll just take a while. And the nice thing to remember is that iconic photo has never left humanity. It never left our consciousness. It never left the places where it's always been a thing of historical record. It just left Facebook for a little bit. And we do have a tendency to freak out and want to jump on Facebook or whoever immediately and go, look what you've done and look how terrible your algorithm is and you're a bad website. But at the end of the day, we're talking about a blip in the system. And I'm like you. I'm very positive and kind of rising road sort of attitude about the future of this stuff. And I'm actually pretty excited about it. It's the false positives that are going to bite us in the butt, though, and that's going to happen for a little bit. And I might not even be able to type "bite me in the butt" on a website.
Don't try typing in "butt" in iOS messages because you don't know what you're going to get.
That's true.
Exactly.
Well, I mean, I don't know why they don't do it the Instagram way. Like Instagram, what they're doing now is, you can filter your own words, and then if someone posts a comment with that word on your picture, the only person who sees that is the person that posted the comment. Like, I love that because it's like that. I don't see that as a violation of free speech. And I love the idea that troll thinks that there were, whatever they needed to get out of themselves by posting that word on someone's picture, they've gotten it out of themselves and no one sees it but them.
They did it and they moved on. Conversation AI really seems like a tool to target, to locate this stuff and then put the power, the kind of action that's taken as a result of that location, let's say, and put that in the hands of whoever happens to be using it. For example, Times and Wikimedia, they're the first to kind of try this out. Times is using it to detect and then automatically blocking if it detects positive, let's say, of trollish or you know, bad behavior, bad language, whatever the case may be, and then the humans go in, the humans march in, and they do whatever they're going to do there. They have like a smaller pool of things to basically approve or reject for good. So it's a tool to kind of help find these things. I guess they trained it with 17 million comments from Time Stories, with 130,000 discussions from Wikipedia pages, and they say it's 92% effective, 10% false positive rate. And I mean, you know, taking that Facebook story as the example, I mean, that I don't know if that's necessarily considered like a false positive in the world of AI. Like, yes, it was triggered, but it was yet to be decided on. And then it was decided on and put back up. So in essence, it's kind of doing what AI does all the time, although with a little bit of human interaction. It made a mistake, it learned from that mistake, and now going forward, it's going to do something different. So.
Yeah, I'm a fan of this work. I hope Google, they've called it tackling the world's toughest geopolitical challenges, or one of them. Mm-hmm. And I agree, it truly is. Like, the way we're communicating online, we are quickly learning there are many cracks in the cement, and we've got to figure out a way to fill those. However, I think it's always important to remind ourselves, and I have to do this too, but it's really important to remind ourselves that when companies are striving for this level of, I don't want to call it, the word censorship isn't right, but this level of machine learning so that the machines can do massive amounts of work that would be impossible without, you know, a fleet of people to do it. Mm-hmm. When we're asking those machines to do it and something gets pulled away, or even if a human being in charge of something at Facebook pulls it away for you, just using Facebook as the example again, it's important to remember that we're not talking about squashing free speech here. We're talking about editing something you said on a platform that is owned and run by an independent company.
Right.
It isn't like some government forum where you were shut down because you were being critical of the government or something like that, where you could say, yeah, you were censoring me. So it's always an important distinction to make that if somebody comes on a website and says a bunch of stuff and it gets removed, moderated in whatever way it was moderated, machines or otherwise, people have a tendency to go straight to censorship, or you are repressing my, in this country, First Amendment rights, and whatever the equivalency is across the world. It's not the way it works. It's basically their call. If they don't want you on there, they don't have to have you on there. And the bigger it gets, the easier it is to get mired in the nuances of that argument. And I realize that there are some arguments to be made about a platform that big with that many users becoming a public forum in a way that should be protected in terms of free speech. So we could have those kinds of arguments, but I just think it's important to remind ourselves that it's a thing that we get to use, and not this live or die sort of interface between us and powers that be at a government or something like that.
Right. That's a good point.